is the time to give your heart. Come just as you are to worship. Come just as you are. One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day every knee will bow. Still the greatest treasure remains for those who gladly choose you now. Come, now is the time for worship. Now is the time to give your heart. Come just as you are to worship. Come just as you are before your God.
Smiling faces, and that's a delight to see. In fact, oh, here comes two more. Nothing like embarrassing them, but I can, because that's my daughter and my grandson. What we're going to do after I do the welcome is I will ask Jen, as our director of youth and family ministry, to stand, as well as the members of the Christian Ed Committee. And I will thank God for them, for the program, for the parents, the teachers, the children. But then I will bless them, meaning Jen and the committee. And then pass it off to Jen to bless the teachers, the children, and the backpacks. So I do want to also mention in the But you are so professional by just standing there. Very nice. Your years of theatrical experience
have paid off at Second Church.
The other thing that I was going to mention is that I will be blessing the briefcases, which were donated by Beth Stendicki after her husband passed away. And those briefcases will be a blessing because they are going to be passed on to Terry Coughlin, who works with victims of domestic violence. And a lot of times when victims of domestic violence have to leave, they have to leave quickly. And what will happen is they leave with only the clothes on their back. And so what the Connecticut Alive, which is what the organization she is affiliated with, what they do is they get the people professional clothing, and now they can provide briefcases as well. So we'll do the singing praises, and then we will do the "This is the day the Lord has made." Thank you.
Please stand.
Oh,
Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus. Woke up this morning with my mind stayed on Jesus.
This coming program here at UCC Second Congregational Church. We thank you for each and every one of the children who will attend our program this year. We thank you for the parents and guardians who will come to church with their children. We thank you for those who volunteer and through their volunteering will help make this Sunday school year possible. May that sense of service always be a big part of their life. We thank you for Jen Thielen, our Director of Children and Family Ministries, as well as the youth group. We thank you for the Board of Christian Education and its volunteers who plan out each year so that we can teach our children about God, Jesus, faith, love, and service. We thank you for Beth Stednicki and the life of John Stednicki and the briefcases who will find a new life. Those briefcases are blessed now through the fact that they have been donated, and the briefcases will be blessed again when Jen blesses the teachers, the children, and the backpacks. God, let Jen and those on the Board of Christian Education know that you are with them when things are good, and let them know that you are with them when things don't go as planned. Let all of them know that it's through their work and their volunteering that we have a program which teaches children and adults alike about you and your son. Scott Clark isn't here this morning. He's canoeing with his family in the Adirondacks, but bless Scott Clark as he continues to lead adult Bible study throughout this program year. Glory to God who is able to do far beyond all that we could ask or imagine. By the immense divine power at work within us. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now Jen will bless the teachers, the students, and the backpacks.
Oh yeah.
If you would.
So Some of you have got to stand back up because your teachers also, Sunday school teachers, come forward. Can I have all the children come in the front row, please? Here, you can sit right here. You got to stay over here. Until we start. Come on forward. Yeah, fill it up. Fill it. This is a party, people. It's Welcome Back Sunday. Come on down. Come on down. First of all, can you all hear me without a microphone? Okay, excellent. Welcome. Welcome. It's so good to be back and see all of these faces. Does anybody know what this is? What is it, Landon? It's a pocket. Do you like pockets? Wyatt, what do pockets do?
They pop.
They pop, right? Why? Why were they originally created? Do you know? They were originally created to relieve stress, right? This is very similar to bubble wrap, isn't it? Linda might have started the popping trend. Exactly. So they were originally created to help us when we're worried and stuff like that, right? And they kind of work, right? But how could we amp this up and really take care of our worries? Anybody know? Wyatt?
By serving God.
By serving God, by inviting God into this, right? So I have something for everybody. I have a few somethings. And we will start. You get this. These are your own pockets and tags that can go on your backpack. And we'll talk about why in a minute. Yes! Landon is excited. Oh, good, buddy. That's good. Is that everybody that wants one? Teachers, we'll see if there's enough. We'll have to wait, okay? All right, so with this pocket, over on the side over here as you walk out, which we're going to do in a couple minutes to go to Sunday school, there's a stack of prayers that can go with this shaped pocket, okay? But what I have, mine's a little different, right? Mine's a little bigger. And if you can see, there's several different rows in this, right? So what we're going to do, you can get it ready if you want. And I may not pop all of them now. I'm not a fast popper. You are, I can tell. That's awesome. So you'll get the idea though. What we have here, we're going to use this as a prayer popper. And you can use yours as a prayer popper too. Aurora, what does the tag say that you can hang that all on your backpack? What does it say?
It says, with God, all things are possible.
With God, all things are possible, right? And that's a pretty cool reminder as we go to school, right? Who's stressed at school? Anybody get a little stressed at school? Maybe a little anxious? No? Well, you guys are living your best life. School can be stressful sometimes, right? Yeah, Landon, thank you. Right? Maybe we get a little worried. We don't know what's going to happen. Maybe we forgot our homework or a juice box. Anything is possible with God, and that's a nice reminder to have. So this prayer, this is a little different. Yours is smaller. We're going to do some praying because Wyatt said if we invite God into our worries, right, then we can feel secure and protected. So on this first row, I'm going to pray for all the people we don't know, right? But we know that they need our prayers. What would be an example of some people we don't know directly? What do you got?
People
that, that's close, that's another row. Wyatt said people that know people that are in this building. We will get to neighbors and community in just a minute. I'm thinking, really, what about people on the other side of the world? Right? Are there any people on the other side of the world that might be going through a hard time right now? There really could be. Do we know them? Do we know that they're struggling though? Do we know we can include God and help them in prayer? Right? Then We are going to pray for all of our leaders. And leaders may not be like kings or things like that, but they're also people that keep us safe. So who would be in here? This is a special group of people. Wyatt.
DJ
Graham Cracker. You know what? That's great. DJ Graham Cracker keeps you safe and is a leader, right? She might be even closer in the friend and family category, so we'll get to that. Here we're going to pray for people like police officers, firefighters, teachers, okay? Our Sunday school teachers, right? That's where Mrs. Baldwin would fall. Some of us can fall in a lot of these different things, and that's kind of cool too. So we're going to pray for the people that also keep us safe, but can they do it without God too though? No, so we're going to include that, right? Then we're going to include our neighbors and community. Who might that be? Who might our neighbors and community be? Maybe Jerry Byers, right? Jerry Byers, that guy right there in the purple. So we can pray for him and everybody behind you, right? In this yellow, Wyatt.
Like neighbors that worship God, like we're neighbors.
A church family, right? Absolutely, a church family. Then it's getting a little different. We got green now. Who would we worship next? We're getting closer and closer. Not yet, bud. Not yet. Right? Here we would pray for our family. So Aurora, who might you pray for here? Your parents, your brother, right? Yeah, we will pray for our family. What do you think this last row? It's not really a row, it's white.
Me.
For you, Landon, you've been waiting to say that, and we can pray for ourselves, right? And on the prayer papers that you will receive, it shows you different ways. You can break that down. Say you want to just pray for just your family in a quick prayer. You can say the name of each family person as you pop one down, okay? Or say you are sad one day. You can say the things that you are sad about and pop one as you go through your prayer. My favorite, you're grateful, you are thankful. And you can pop and say things that you are thankful for in a prayer, okay? So let us pray. These tags can go on your backpacks to help remind you that you're not alone, that anything is possible. And I got a little pop-it to pray with as well, right? So let us be in the spirit of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for giving us this opportunity to be together, to worship you, to learn about you with our church family. Lord, we have many tools and devices that may help us when we get worried or sad, but nothing is more effective and promising than walking in faith with you. Let us, Lord, remember that as we have our habits, as we bring them to school and live our lives, that you will be with us always. And because of that, anything is possible. Lord, let us take this rainbow and pray for those that we don't even know all the way on the other side of the world, or maybe even here in Westfield. We know there are people out there that are struggling, that really need your love and protection. Lord, there are some people that we don't know that need you to be in their hearts. May those doors be open for them. Lord, let us pray for our neighbors, our community members. Let us pray, Lord, for our church families. Lord, let us pray for those that teach and lead and protect us. And especially this year, our brand new Sunday school volunteer staff. Lord, be in their hearts and minds as they guide these children and hold their hands on this amazing faith journey to you and with you. Lord, please be with our immediate families as we embark on a new school year. We may have busy schedules. Lord, let us know no matter
how busy we may get with our families, there is always, always time and room to be with you. Lord, please be with our closest friends. May we be the light for them and teach them about you too. Lord, help us to remember that with you, all things are possible. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Okay, so now Sunday school and teachers are going to come upstairs all together to start. Meet everybody. Then we'll split up. Before I do that, though, we are having a picnic. I'm telling you guys this. We got food after church, okay? And if there's any church members that would like to get to know the Sunday school families and Sunday school teachers and be fed, please raise your hand so we know we have enough tables set up if anyone is staying after church. Wonderful. You guys are going to have a lot of food. We can't wait to see you. Thank you. So we can go upstairs. You can take a bookmark, too, that'll help you through the week.
I got this one,
buddy. I'm not giving you money, buddy. Sorry. Just a bookmark.
Morning's call to worship. Lord, we have come this day to hear your words of healing, of love, and of hope. Enter our hearts and our spirits and teach us to follow you. Give us the courage and strength to be your faithful disciples. Amen.
Today's opening hymn is in an insert in your bulletin. Cry of my heart. Please rise. And the last time through, we'll do the chorus twice.
Of my life.
me in the prayer of confession. Lord, it is easy for us to say that we will follow you, and then turn our backs and act as though our commitment to you does not mean anything to us. Jesus challenges us to take our crosses, and when we don't understand what that means, we just show up and turn away. Forgive us for our heart and commitment to faith. Heal us from our greed and fears. Give us courage to be disciples, and enable us to joy in the claim of your healing mercies and your transformational love. We ask this in Jesus' name, who taught us with grace and our Father, who art in heaven.
Receive the healing love of Jesus. Give your lives to his service by serving and caring for others. Be at peace.
This morning's psaltery lesson comes to us from the Book of Psalms, chapter 19, 1 through 4, and 7 through 14. As an intro, this psalm speaks to about the Lord's instruction and the Lord's law. So it is quite appropriate psalm to read as we kick off Sunday school program this year. If someone has accidentally done the wrong, the psalmist knows that the Lord will clear them of those unknown sins. Psalms are found in the Old Testament. We know from the New Testament that Jesus washed away the sins of the world when Jesus died on the cross. The heavens are telling the glory of God, and the firmament proclaims his handiwork. Day to day pours forth speech, and the night to declare the knowledge. There is no speech, nor are there words. Their voices is not heard, yet their voice goes out through all the earth. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving his soul.
The Lord's law is perfect. The Lord's regulations are right, light in the heart. The Lord's commands are pure, giving light
to
the eyes.
Honoring the Lord is correct, lasting forever. The Lord's judgments are true. All of these are righteous. They are more desirable than gold, than tons of pure gold. They are sweeter than honey, even dripping off the honeycomb. No doubt about it. Your servant is enlightened by them. There is great reward in keeping them.
But can they know what they have accidentally done wrong? Clear me of any unknown sin, and save your servant from willful sins. Don't let them wound me. Then I'll be completely cleansed. I'll be innocent of great wrongdoing. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my Redeemer.
Our New Testament lesson comes from James 3, 1 through 12. This passage speaks directly to those of us who teach. We all make mistakes, but those of us who are in a position to influence others must guard our tongues and our words. As the scripture says, a small flame can set a whole forest on fire. Hear now the words from the third chapter of James. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers and sisters, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. For all of us who make mistakes, anyone who makes no mistakes in speaking is perfect, able to keep the whole body in check with a bridle. If we put bits in the mouths of horses to make them obey us, we guide them with their whole bodies. Or look at ships through they are so large that it takes strong moves to drive them. Yet they are guided by a very small rudder, wherever the will of the pilot directs. So also the tongue in a small member, yet it boasts of great exploits. How great a forest is set ablaze by a small fire, and the tongue is a fire. The tongue is placed among members of the world and inequity. It strands the whole body, sets afire the cycle of nature, and it itself set on fire by hell. For every species of beast and bird of reptile and sea creatures can be tamed and has been tamed by the human species, but no one can tame the tongue, a restless evil full of deadly poison. With it we bless the Lord and Father, and with it we curse those who are made in the likeness of God. From the same mouth comes the blessing and cursing. My brothers and sisters, this ought to be so. Does a spirit pour forth the same opening both fresh and brackish water? Can a fig tree, my brothers and sisters, yield olives or a grapevine fig? No more than salt yield. No more than salt water yield fresh.
Thank you, York. Who do you say that I am? That's the question Jesus posed to Peter. In December, as Advent begins, we will be meditating on that question, actually leading up to that point. Who do you say that Jesus is? And how have you come to feel that way? Hear the words from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 8. Jesus went on with his disciples to the villages of Caesarea Philippi. And on the way, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that I am?" And they answered him, "John the Baptist, the others, Elijah, and still others, one of the prophets." He asked them, "But who do you say that I am?" Peter answered him, "You are the Messiah." And Jesus sternly ordered him not to tell anyone about him. Then he began to teach them that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days, rise again. He said all this quite openly, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he, Jesus, rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Jesus called a crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves, take up their cross, and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake, for the sake of the gospel, will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our God is still speaking. We need to keep listening. Now, please be with me in a spirit of prayer, a prayer that will sound extraordinarily familiar because it was part of the psalm that we read this morning. And notice that when I say, may the meditations of our hearts be acceptable and pleasing to you, some translations say acceptable, some say pleasing. I always combine them both. So please be with me in a spirit of prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable and pleasing to you, O Lord, our rock and our Redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
A lot of tragedies have happened recently. Afghanistan, Haiti, the hurricanes, the tropical storms. There were lives lost, and there was property damaged. A couple of times a year when events like this occur, whether natural or man-made, I feel that it's necessary to say to people that those people who lost their lives, those people who lost their possessions, they didn't do anything wrong. God was not punishing them. Sometimes bad things happen to good people. Rabbi Harold Kushner wrote a book entitled When Bad Things Happen to Good People. I highly recommend the book. Rabbi Kushner and his wife lost their 14-year-old son to a disease called progeria, which is called the aging disease. The God that Rabbi Kushner and I worship doesn't single people out for tragedy. The God we worship stays close to those who have suffered tragedy. That's why the prayer I often say is a two-pronged prayer. One is that I ask God to stay especially close to the person who is suffering. But the second prong is that I ask that the person who is suffering feel God's presence. When people are new to the Christian faith, this is something I say 2 to 3 times a year. When people are new to the Christian faith, they think that once they start the life of a Christian, once they start attending church, that their life is going to be all puppies and pansies and daffodils, and it's not. It's a natural assumption that their day-to-day troubles will fade away as soon as they start attending church and start building their faith, and that's not the way it works. I wish I could say that it did, but it's just not true. The day-to-day struggles will still be there. The difference is that as we lean more on God, we will find that our troubles won't seem quite so overwhelming. As you attend church more and more, you'll begin to hear the term intercessory prayer. That's when we pray for someone or a particular situation. That's when we're praying during the joys and concerns. The prayers we pray are intercessory prayer, and sometimes the people know that we're praying for them, and sometimes they don't. That's the beauty of intercessory prayer. Whether we know or whether they know that we're praying for them or not, God always knows. That's why I encourage people to share their struggles when they feel comfortable doing so. Why? Because we're all in this together. We're a church family. I never share someone's struggles without their expressed permission. And I understand that we each need time to process life-altering events. That said, intercessory prayer works, and as we widen our support network, church family can also take care of the more practical needs, such as rides to appointments and meals. Sometimes it's nice to find out that someone else has gone through what we're going through, and they made it through to the other side. They lend support because they've struggled. They have been where we are going. They know that we can make it through as well. That's one reason I felt that it was important for Second Congregational Church to take part in the overdose awareness vigil last week. I gave the invocation and the benediction, and Jen Thielen was the keynote speaker. I felt that it was important for the church to take part so that the people there know that God loves them, and so do we. When someone is going through a tough time, it's easy to feel overwhelmed and lonely. It's easy to feel that we're the only one going through it, or even worse, we're the only one who has ever gone through it. And when there's some sort of addiction issue, or mental health issue, there's often a sense of shame that goes along with that loneliness. There's a sense of shame that keeps the problem hidden and perpetuates the stigma associated with it. One of the reasons that I preach so often on the humanity of Jesus is that we worship a God who gets us. We worship a God who came to earth as a baby. We worship a God who has experienced being unjustly accused, experienced having friends betray him, experienced having other friends disappear when he needed them the most. God gets every trial and tribulation we face because our God faced those trials and tribulations as well. Jesus faced the cross alone. He endured the intentional humiliation and excruciating pain. Jesus was left to die on the cross by suffocating. Our God gets it. He gets what it's like to be human. That's to say that God knows what it's like when we are at our lowest. That's why it's my belief that Jesus kept telling his disciples over and over and over again that the Son of Man must go to Jerusalem, undergo great suffering, be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, the scribes, and be killed, and after three days, rise again. Jesus was telling his disciples about the horror, but Jesus was telling his disciples also about the sense of hope that would triumph. Jesus was telling his disciples death and sin would never, ever again have the last word. At that time, though, the disciples couldn't understand what Jesus was talking about. We have the benefit of knowing about the resurrection, but they didn't know what was about to happen. Now let's look at the other side of Jesus being human and divine. Jesus would have known what lay ahead of him. Jesus would have known what lay ahead for his followers. This particular piece of scripture falls right there in the center of Mark's gospel. Up until now, the action was centered around Galilee as Jesus began his ministry. From this point of the scripture on, everything will point toward Jerusalem. And it will point toward Jesus' death on the cross. Jesus didn't want to die. Who would? And how do we know that Jesus didn't want to die? Do you remember the words in the Garden of Gethsemane? Jesus kept repeating the phrase, asking that the hour pass from him and the cup be removed. Each time, though, Jesus ends the plea with the phrase, not my will, but thy will be done. Jesus knew that his path led to Jerusalem into the cross. Peter was trying to protect Jesus, but Peter was tempting Jesus. And by tempting Jesus, Peter was standing in the way of what Jesus needed to accomplish. Peter was hindering the one thing that would allow God's mercy and salvation for all of humanity. Peter's actions were rooted in love, which is going to be the theme for the stewardship campaign. Rooted in love. But our stewardship campaign is going to be rooted in love to be a beacon of hope. Peter's actions were rooted in love, but they were misguided. The life of a Christian isn't easy. The work that needs to be done isn't easy. But it's work that needs to be done, and through it all, we are promised that God will be with us. God will not forsake us. From now until Advent, the four Sundays, Advent is the four Sundays leading up to Christmas. From now until Advent, I want each of us to meditate on the question Jesus asked Peter. Who do you say that I am? We know that Jesus is the one we worship. Jesus died on the cross. Jesus forgave our sins. But I'm asking a more personal question, a more practical question. I want you to think about the Jesus, the way you relate to Jesus. Is your Jesus the compassionate Jesus who is with you when you are your lowest? Is your Jesus the one who is overturning the tables in the temple? The Jesus that gives you the righteous indignation to fight for social justice? Is your Jesus the one who sees those who are on the margins, who no one else seems to see, and invites them back into community? That's the Jesus who instructs us to welcome the stranger, feed the hungry, and see those who have been ignored by society. Jesus was a multifaceted human. It's possible that you'll be following one aspect of Jesus one day and another aspect of Jesus another day. It's not one and done. We are to align ourselves with Jesus every minute of every day. When there is a question in our minds, there used to be that bracelet, "What would Jesus do?" That's what we're to be thinking about. As a church, Second Congregational Church has discerned that God is calling us to be a beacon of hope. If we are committed to doing God's work here in Westfield, we must come to terms with the fact that the way will not always be easy. In fact, the way most often will be difficult. But we are assured that God will be with us every step of the way. In closing, I want to circle back to Peter for just a moment. Jesus asked Peter, "Who do you say that I am?" And Peter answered that Jesus was the Messiah, the one who has come to save us. But then Peter, in his very next breath, tried to keep Jesus from doing what God had called Jesus to do. As we work to be the beacon of hope here in Westfield, will we be causing others to stumble and fall, or will we be building people up and encouraging them to follow the way of Jesus? Will we be compassionate with the weak and mighty with the haughty? Will we see those who are on the sidelines, wherever they happen to be, out there or in here, and actually see them and fight for them and fight for those who cannot fight for themselves? Are we willing to do that and whatever it takes to be the beacon of hope here in Westfield and stay the beacon of hope here in Westfield? Jesus deserves nothing less than the best that we can give at any single moment in time. And if we bring our best to Jesus, Jesus will take care of everything else. Amen.
Amen.
to a time of our joys and concerns. It's good to see Betty and Bill here, and I'm sorry Betty lost her brother Carlton this past week. Josh Gravel-Blaney is preparing for surgery. Prayers for those who are still struggling in the aftermath of the hurricanes and tornadoes. Prayers for the refugees from Afghanistan who are beginning new lives with little more than the clothes on their back. God, please be with them as they start their lives over in a foreign land. Prayers of thanksgiving for these briefcases, which will find a new home and a new beginning for those who have been hurt in the past. Prayers for those who are facing medical conditions. Prayers for the members of the congregation who are preparing for upcoming surgery or recovering from recent surgery. Nicole's family needs her entire family needs our prayers. Her mom has cancer, her dad, her mom, Josh, everything. You know, just keep those prayers coming. It's something we can do it, and it has power in it. Prayers for the entire Wallace family. Prayers for those who are grieving. Prayers for Tom and his wife. Prayers for Charlie, Francis, and Jonathan S. and his family. Prayers for Liza M. Prayers for Dan, Sue F., and her siblings. Prayers for those who are unemployed. Prayers for those who are beginning a new chapter in their lives. Prayers for teachers and children who are beginning a new school year. And special prayers for those classes and schools already doing remote learning because of COVID. And prayers for John and Ruth. I will leave a moment of silence so that we can reflect on those names and situations which were just read aloud or may still be in the recesses of our heart. Gracious God, we come to you thankful for this opportunity to gather together. We thank you for all that has gone well this week. And we humbly come before you and ask that you be with those people and situations I just read aloud. Please also be with the people and situations we now lift up to you in silence. God of mercy and hope, be with us this day. We have gathered here to learn of your will for us. Sometimes it's not easy for us to realize that if we are to follow Jesus, we have to make a total commitment to his ways. We will have to actually put into practice the good news of compassionate love and healing mercies. Our hearts are filled with situations concerning family and friends, concerning neighborhood and world. We seek your healing mercies for these situations. Help us to remember that the same healing mercy is offered to each one of us. Give us strength and courage to really follow Jesus, for it is in his name we pray. Amen. Every generous act of giving, as with every perfect gift, is from above. God's word of truth implanted within us at birth bloom in acts of loving faithfulness. May that word shape our lives so that we become doers of the word, using God's gifts for all. There's an opportunity to leave your offering, your pledge, your tithe, in the offering basket as you leave. Please be with me in a spirit of prayer. God of light and beauty, every gift is from you. Even our ability to give is a blessing of your love. We offer that we have and what we are. Use our gifts to give birth to a world of righteousness where none in need. Thank you. Close to your... Amen. I wrote it and I didn't even get it right. God, you know what is in our hearts, even when our mouths don't work right. Thank you, God. Amen.
Please rise for our final hymn, Give Thanks, which is in your bulletin.
Necessary, use words. Amen.